Okay. I'm Tetsu Kim from Georgia Tech. In fact, all the project they're going to describe is backed by large team, including the people from Oregon State University and Microsoft Research at KAIST and as well. So this is the basic outline of my talk. I'm going to quickly summarize the threat model of SGX so that you can understand what are the security issues there. And also, I'm going to cover the traditional attack vectors, and then I'm going to tell you about the new attack vectors, very specialized for Intel SGX. And I'm going to quickly summarize the entire talk. The difference between the traditional attack vectors and new attack vectors is quite kind of subtle. But one thing that I want to emphasize is that the traditional attack vector is just some kind of attack that you can see from the traditional applications. Without even SGX, it completely makes sense to use those exploitation techniques. So new attack vector, on the other hand, is more specialized to SGX. That somehow they're going to rely on some kind of features of SGX. In traditional attack vector, I'm going to cover cache-based side channel, and then memory safety issues and mitigation techniques, and we're going to announce a new attack called uninitialized padding issue, which just allowed to share those information with public. And I'm going to quickly move to new attack vector, starting from page table attacks and branch shadowing attack. Lastly, we're going to demonstrate how to lock down the entire data center by using Rollhammer inside SGX. In fact, this it contains a lot of other people's work as well. So I try to explicitly mark those. We also have a complete list of the paper in SGX is compiled by Intel. So if you're interested in, these are good resources. You can start checking the latest research in SGX. So let me quickly review you what is SGX. It's basically a practical implementation made by Intel. The practicality is the most important design aspect of SGX. In other words, it supports native performance on like like Trustzone, and also it's compatible to x86. If you're the normal programmer, you can just jump in to SGX programming at the first day. Lastly, it's a commodity, which means it's everywhere, even without noticing you. If you bought the new machine these days, you already have SGX. So in other words, it's good to think about how to use SGX in commodity hardware. So in terms of cloud, SGX provides a way to launch a program in secure way, in an isolated manner, inside the cloud provider environment. In this case, the secure program that I want to protect will be run inside the enclave. In other words, we have a threat model from applications and operating system, which means we don't have to trust them, but we can still launch the application without relying on those people. In fact, SGX is not just a local the protection. It also provides a way to create the channel from the client all the way down to the enclave inside the cloud provider. In order to achieve this, Intel provides a way to attestate your program by using EPID infrastructure. So in terms of attack, the green mark are the component that we are kind of trusting, all the Intel CPU and Intel's infrastructure and some kind of code inside the client program as well. And in terms of attack, we can think of this one as an attacker. Basically, all the trust component is as an attacker where we should attack those so that we can actually break the security of the SGX. And in terms of attacker's capability, all the devil mark is what attacker can do. You have higher privileges like operating systems, and you can obtain the hardware like cloud provider. These are all the attacker's capability when we are attacking SGX. So we can start the attack in various components in entire ecosystems as attacker, but we're going to focus only on the isolation features of SGX in local setting or this particular region. The EPID infrastructure is kind of unknown, and it's not also popular these days. So it's okay to attack those components, but it's not our priority. Similarly, you can attack the client-side infrastructure that can load the program, attestate the program, but also it's not interesting because there's so many non-technical issues you have to overcome first before we talk about all the technical details. So all the interesting aspect for us as an attacker is to stay in the local component. So In other words, we're gonna trying to break their isolations and confidentiality that SGX is providing. Could you hear me well? Like Michael is just falling down all the time. There are two important design goals in SGX. One is performance again. We're gonna revisit this one because a lot of security property that SGX provides is depend on this design criteria. Second of all, it's a general purpose. Two important security perimeter that they provide is isolated execution so that we can get the confidentiality integrity and also remote execution. Again, we're gonna focus only on the isolated execution. Okay, isolated execution is nothing but the encrypted physical memory we call EPC region. So all the memory traffic coming from the CPU to that particular physical memory region will be encrypted. In other words, when we launch an enclave, this physical pages will be multiplexed to the user space, basically map this physical space to the virtual address region. So multiple enclave can utilize those physical memory. In terms of attacks, because of those isolation feature, we can prevent access from a virtual machine monitor and operating system. Not only that, we can prevent the access across the enclave because they run on the different virtual address space. Not only that, all the hardware that can launch DMA attacks and etc. cannot even snoop the memory traffic going to the physical memory space. In terms of threat model, it provides extremely strong threat model. All the components except the core package that rely on the SGX can be malicious. In other words, all the hardware, including device drive, device and firmware, and also all the privileged software like operating system and hypervisor can be malicious attacker. So naturally, denial of service is out of concern because you obtain the hardware and you can simply turn off the execution of the running enclave. So in other words, all the security issue related to DOS is not kind of interesting in terms of attacks. Also, because of the performance region, the Intel explicitly through the cache-based side channel. Without cache in modern computing architecture, it's nothing to talk about the performance. It's the most important component is the cache for performance. Then before we talk about actual attack, let's just think a little bit about what if enclave is compromised. In fact, what I mean by compromise is that you lost your control flow inside the enclave program. So as an attacker, you can literally do some arbitrary computation inside the SGX. So what are the implications? Thanks to your strong isolation guarantee made by the hardware, that as a defense, as a user, there's no way to observe what SGX is working or what are the resources they're using. So because of security property that SGX provides, it's extremely hard to monitor once your program is compromised. Not only that, all the application running inside the SGX is kind of handling some secret information. So you can dump all the secret information outside of your enclave and you can leak those to the attacker. Not only that, you can even install the rootkit inside the SGX. So you can do the man-in-the-middle attack. Then you can permanently parasite into the SGX program to make it very unsafe after those compromise. The thing that I really want to emphasize is that due to this strong threat model and consequences of compromises, developing a secure enclave program is way more difficult than developing a traditional application. A lot of people have a impression that just applying SGX to your program is making your program completely secure, but not the case. Actually, extremely hard to make your SGX program harder and so that prevent the compromise from the attacker. So we concretize those attacks so that we demonstrate how to dump the confidential data from the users from enclave to the outside, and also we demonstrate how to create a permanent parasite. So feel free to check those paper, but we're gonna cover the first part about the how to leak the confidential data inside SGX later. So before we talk about those, let's focus on the cache-based side channel. Again, we talk about the Intel doesn't care about cache side channel. Now, why people in security community generating those kind of research output? It's interesting because the cache attacks, although Intel says it's not possible, it don't care, but cache-based attacks are still possible. Sometimes because of this stronger threat model, cache side channel attack against SGX sometimes extremely easier, or sometimes it's extremely harder as well. But what's interesting here is all the existing defense mechanism can be similarly applicable to those contexts. So not many people in our community exploit the security property of SGX to get the cache-based side channel more difficult or easier. So I got this question all the time. So should we care about the cache-based side channel when you're building data center that support SGX? It depends on the context and application, of course. Sometimes you have an impression the cache-based side channel is extremely dangerous, but in reality, it's extremely hard to exploit. This is an indirect attack. Even after the cache-based side channel, there are so many stuff that you have to achieve. And sometimes people have an impression that this is extremely dangerous, but sometimes they ignore the fact that they weigh more the performance over a potential risk that you have. So you have to think about the performance versus security when you're applying any defensive mechanism against cache. But what's interesting here is that SGX sometimes make cache-based side channel easier because as an attacker, we can utilize all the privilege instructions like PMU, unlike the other cache-based side channel in the other application. Sometimes it's extremely hard to exploit because as SGX programmer, you can leverage the isolation feature so that we can create the randomizations, we can place your data in random fashion. This security value of security becomes extremely practical in the context of SGX. By leveraging them, we can completely hide those access patterns from the attacker. So that's why Intel explicitly noted that it's better to address those cache-based side channel in software rather than the hardware. So instead of making default security mechanism, we better selectively apply this defense mechanism to defeat the cache-based side channel. So let's quickly move to more interesting attack, the memory safety issue inside SGX. In fact, SGX is not free from memory safety issues. Even worse, most of the current ecosystem that provided by Intel is built on top of memory unsafe languages, namely C. So we kind of propose a way to exploit this memory unsafe vulnerability, particularly buffer overflow. And also there is a ton of interesting work, particularly SGX bounds wanting to address those memory safety issues. So I'd like to revisit those papers as well. So in order to understand how to exploit the buffer overflow inside SGX, let's quickly revisit the ROP, the return-oriented programming. So this is a vulnerable function getting input as an argument, and there's a local variable destination. And then in the program, they copy the input to the destination with the larger size, in this case, 200. Thanks to this buffer overflow, you can override the return address. And not only that, you can override the rest of the argument so that we chain this return address to the particular snip of instruction, in this case, pop gadget, the instruction that contains and pop and return. By doing so, we can literally invoke arbitrary function. In this case, we can invoke the libc, system call with the particular argument in this bin shell, so you get the get shell out of this buffer overflow. Now, what do you mean by applying ROP inside the SGX? In fact, by applying ROP to the SGX, we don't, as an attacker, we don't have any visibility inside the code because of the isolation feature that they provide. So as an attacker, however, we know the fact that the program is start crashing. So by observing their crashing behavior, we can kind of infer the size of the buffer. And by carefully adjusting the input to the buffer, and by checking their crashing point, in this case, 108, by simply checking those, without seeing the actual code, we can still guess what are the size of the buffer. By leveraging this attack, we can essentially build up our exploitation so that essentially invoke the memcopy so that we can dump the entire program outside of your running enclave. First, we're gonna locate all the pop gadget without knowing the content by leveraging the previous technique that I described. And then we're gonna locate the enclave U function. This is a dispatching instruction. So that by leveraging this instruction, so we're gonna decipher every single pop gadget that we collected. And lastly, we're gonna find out the main copy as a last step of exploitation. So as an attacker again, we have higher privileges. Yes. I'm gonna talk about every single step in detail. So don't worry about. So as your attacker, we kind of know the layout of the program because we are the one who place your layout for the running enclave. So as your attacker, you don't even have to break something. You know the beginning of the code section of the enclave. So in this case, because of the buffer overflow and the program is crashing, we know how to change the return address. So instead of putting 108, what if we point to the beginning of the code section and start scanning and see how this program is behaving? So most of the cases, it just crash based on the return address that we injected. But sometimes, think about this particular case. What if we change the return address, point to the pop gadget, the pop and return, then return address, instead of it crashing at the 108, it start crashing at 118, the one of the argument that we injected after. Similarly, what if we have a multiple pop gadget? There's a 3 pop gadget in this case. After we execute the pop, 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 and return, we simply move the return address to the 128 in this case. So by simply checking those crashing sites, we can kind of leverage that we invoke the multiple pop gadget. So at the end of those scanning, we can have a catalog, say, this particular address region contains 1 pop gadget, some particular address region has a multiple pop gadget. So once we collect all those pop gadgets, but we still don't know the contents of a pop gadget, because when program crashing, the hardware, the enclave hardware is cleaning up all the register file. But what's interesting about this enclave view function is basically dispatching the multiple enclave feature that they want to use. Like if you specify 0 value, they're gonna create the report. Or more interestingly, if you specify the 4, they're gonna terminate the enclave program. What's interesting property of enclave exit is that when they're terminating, they just leave the instruction, the register file as it is. So unlike when an enclave program crash, they're gonna automatically clean up all the register file. But we intentionally terminate the program, then we can see the remaining register file. So we're gonna leverage this information to locate the enclave view function. So in order to do this, we basically put the 4 value, which is the exit, and we're gonna call the pop gadget, and then we're gonna change the return address in this way. So we can kind of control the enclave view so that we can intentionally force the exit of the enclave program. And in this case, we're gonna put every single pop gadget we know and start manipulating this crashing behavior. So in this case, what if we put the argument and 1 and 2 right after the pop gadget? And then we see the crashing behavior from the register file. We say RSI is equal to 1, RDI is equal to 2. In this case, because we put the argument 1 and 2 in this particular order, we can consider that this pop gadget is a pop the RSI and pop RDI by simply checking the register file, thanks to the pattern that we injected to our buffer. By using this, we basically decipher every single pop gadget in our catalog. And by using this, now we can control the argument to the argument to the function. In this case, we are going to scan the main copy. But before that, we're gonna set the argument, say that the destination buffer is outside of my enclave. The source address of the main copy is the beginning of the code function, beginning of the code section of the enclave, and we put some random size. So in this case, if we happen to invoke the main copy, then outside of the enclave region, we will see the code of the enclave program. So in this case, we simply iterate the return address and similarly scan the entire memory space. Once we find some of the data inside the data section, then we can say we finally hit the main copy. In fact, there are tons of gadgets inside the SGX, particularly if you see the SDK, there are so many gadgets, so extremely easy to identify those. Let me show you how it works in the simple demo. So first, we're gonna change the return address to scan the entire code section that we have. It's basically now scanning the pop gadget, start crashing the enclave program. And finally, we have the catalog, in this case, a pop 4 catalog. If you see, attach the GDB to the enclave in debugging mode, you can see the particular pop gadget that we collected. I guess it's, the phone is relatively smaller. similarly, we have a pop gadget like this. Let's check another one. Because sometimes a pop gadget is not just pop gadget because it can be just by side effect. But the last pop gadget contained the four pop, as you can see in the picture. And then we're gonna put the four value to our register, and we're gonna start scanning the enclave view function so that if the program, instead of crashing, not gracefully terminate, we can say that the particular instruction pointer is pointing to the enclave view function. In this case, we finally found the enclave view gadget because it's not crashing. Let's check whether this address actually contains the enclave view function. So in fact, it's kind of a bad instruction because GDB doesn't support the correct OP code of the enclave view. But in fact, this is the actual OP code of enclave view function, instruction. So once we know the enclave view, we're gonna start deciphering entire pop gadget that we have, start injecting particular pattern to the argument and checking their register file at the end. We can kind of map the what particular pop gadget they're invoking. So in this case, we found a omnipotent pop gadget that contains every single register. So we can change every single register by using this single gadget. So once we identify, decipher all the pop gadget, it's a time to look, time to find out the memcopy function. In this case, we're gonna put the destination to copy the memory to the outside of the enclave so we can keep checking those memory regions. We're gonna point to the source, to the code section, so we can see, the actual enclave code running. So in this case, we start scanning, you will see. So we're gonna use this pop gadget in this case. So that this is exactly how we control the argument of memcopy. It contains RSI, RDI, RDX. So in this case, we quickly found the location of memcopy. This is a destination that we are keep monitoring. So this is the initial content. Before that, as you can see, there is an ELF section that was copied from the enclave to the outside. So you now have actual code of running enclave as an attacker by leveraging this attack. So let me talk about how to defend against this kind of attack. There's one very interesting proposal made by some researcher. It's basically, they want to address a special memory problem. It's exactly the problem that I explored in the past. Basically do the bound checking. So for every single memory operation, a memory pointer, they're gonna provide an efficient tag representation. So thanks to SGX limitation on the memory size, it currently only supports 100 megabytes, 200 megabytes, the 4 bytes, but the system architecture is a 64-bit. So that you can have the rest of a 4-byte as a just pointer. So it's enough to point to the memory region inside SGX. For the upper pointer, we're gonna put a metadata that indicate the upper bound of the objects. In this case, when we are referring to the objects, we're gonna just take the lower part of the code pointer and then use an access to the objects by using the upper part of the pointer so that we can pinpoint the upper bound of the objects. In fact, by using this technique, whenever you allocate the extra memory, allocate the memory region, in this case SND, we're gonna propagate this size, the beginning of the object, the end of the object, to the pointer that you're gonna use in this way. And then right before you accessing, in this case, right before load, then they're gonna put the extra check. We're gonna first extract the metadata related to the source code pointer, source pointer, and then check whether the bound is correct or not. Similarly, right before accessing this store, they're gonna check the details, check the metadata in this way, and then check their bound right before storing anything to those memory regions. It's a pretty cool technique, although it's a kind of known technique, but they found out that the SGX is a great fit for this kind of tag tracking by using, by putting extra data on the code pointer. So are we done with the memory safety? In fact, SGX bounds is only temporary solution for many reasons. First, it only addresses temporal, the spatial memory safety issues, so they cannot cover the popular exploitation techniques like UAF, user after free. And also, SGX likely support more memory in the future. So they can probably support larger memory. So many people in community consider the biggest limitation to adopt the SGX is the size of the memory. So they're gonna essentially extend support the large memory region to SGX. So it's probably hard to use this technique. In other words, it's a good idea to contain some of the mitigation inside your SGX program. So then what are the popular mitigation techniques? These are the all the mitigation techniques that you can find on the modern hardware, starting from Stack Canary and Relo and DEP and ASLR. But Intel Azure took some consideration on those mitigation. If you compile your program, the SGX SDK by default provide some kind of mitigation, including Stack Canary. Fortunately, all the SGX program is statically linked, the static image. So Relo is not a big issue in this case. So thanks to those by default option from GCC and all the Intel SDK, you can already got those mitigation. But what about the other two? It's a DEP and ASLR. In fact, the spec one of the SGX doesn't allow to utilize the DEP because there is no way to change the permission in dynamic fashion. So unfortunately, spec two is not being released yet, although spec two provides a dynamic way to change your memory permission. We need some intermediate solution in order to achieve those security mitigation. Not only that, implementing ASLR is extremely difficult. As you can see, that we have a limited memory region. In other words, we don't have much memory entropy. Even if you apply the ASLR to the SGX program, there are so many easy ways to bypass because it already limited contains a limited memory space. In order to avoid this, we propose a method called SGX Shield. It's a compilation method. So if you compile this, we provide a software-based DP and very fine-grained ASLR. The approach of however, implementing this SGX Shield is not that trivial because the kernel is our threat model. So they already have the visibility of entire memory space. So without leaking anything, they already know the code section. So in typical ASLR, knowing the code section is basically you can break every single code pointer inside your library. Not only that, you also have a very small entropy in terms of randomization, because by default, the maximum memory that you can use is by max is about 200 megabytes. And also, there is no way to change your permission. Once you run the program, all the code section that was originally marked as executable was just executable. So our approach to address those problems is to break their loading procedure in multiple stages. We first gonna load a in-enclave loader that basically bootstrapping your loading process, and then they're gonna fetch your encrypted program into the data section, and then we're gonna compute some we're gonna relocate the particular basic block so that we can achieve the fine-grained ASLR mechanism enable, and load and shuffle those fine-grained basic block into the code section and change their permission. Not only that, we also prevent the access to the sensitive data structures like SEC in the SGX, so that all the memory access heading to those sensitive data structures will be prevented. Because most of the data structure inside the SGX that actually contain a static function pointer. So we should, in order to prevent those, we should prevent those accesses as well. Let me quickly show how SGX Shield work. As a pretty short demo, if you see this sample attack, there is an enclave memory, is the beginning of the main function. And here, we're gonna compute the offset between enclave memory, enclave main functions, and hidden function. And this function is somewhat relocated in the memory region, so we keep dumping this offset. And we're gonna compute this offset inside the SGX program. And we first gonna compile this program without ASLR enabled. the SGX shield enable in this way. And then we're gonna run this program. And as you can see, this is the function pointer. And this is the offset. Once you compile without the randomization, let's execute once more. The function pointer, as you can see, they're the same. And you will see the offset is a 40, as a static, as you can see here. And then we're gonna enable SLR. You can simply change your compilation flag with the rand on. Then we're gonna compile this one and enable, insert the bootloaders and provide the fine-grained randomization. So when you run, the actual function pointer is different and the offset is kind of random. When you execute once more, then the function pointer is also keep changing and offset as well is also changing. So you can see the fine-grained randomization going on inside SGX shield program. So this is a simple compilation tool. So you can simply apply your program to those to defend against any kind of memory leakage. So this is another problem that we reported to Intel about 6 months ago. And finally, after the responsible disclosure period, we are allowed to discuss with the public. So this is a data structure. Yeah, this is a very common data structure you can find in the Linux kernel. So what's interesting here, there's a two member variable that each size is an unsigned integer and unsigned character. As you notice here, the size of both are different. And this is a typical way to initialize those member variable inside the struct. Say I want to initialize a device number to 1 and slow as a second member variable as a 0. What's interesting here, because of the size different, the entire device num contains the 4 bytes. On the other hand, slow is just contain 1 byte. The rest of the region, it contains some arbitrary data inside your kernel. What's problematic here is that when they dump this data structure to the user space in the context of operating system, this particular uninitialized data might contain some sensitive information, like private key, in the case of the Heartbleed vulnerability. It really depends on the context of application. In fact, we found this vulnerability in the context of operating system. We end up finding about 20 vulnerability. We also checked that, interestingly enough, we checked the SGX as well. And this is how you define the communication between SGX and outside world. It's called enclave description languages. It basically defined an E call and O call, and that this particular call contained the argument as a test struct. What if this test struct contained a padding byte, which is popular common, then when you invoke the E call, you can inject some of the data inside the enclave memory region. When the enclave invoked the O call, then we can kind of get the uninitialized data from the enclave, which might be some sensitive data you are computing. So we highlight the details of those attack procedures and potential defense mechanism. So feel free to check this report. And let me show you how this works quickly as a demo. We call this attack as SGX bleed. It's keep leaking the private data inside the SGX. This is how we define the equal structure. This is EDL. The enclave description languages, it simply return the data structure like this. So when you call this equal, equal simply return the data structure. It copy the entire data structure as it is to the outside. And this particular data structure is a struct contain this padding region right after this value 1 and 2 because of the size difference between them. And this is the SGX application that we're going to run. We're first going to call the equal so that we can get the return value. And inside the enclave program, we are going to do... we first going to allocate this memory region and do some arbitrary computation. In this case, fill some data to the memory region. And then as you can see, at the end, we're going to free this memory region inside SGX. So we do the some sensitive information, allocate the sensitive data like private key, to the computations and release. And after that, we're going to create another data structure that for communicating to the outside world, in this case, test struct, that happen to contain a padding region. In this case, we nicely initialize correctly by using all the pattern. And then when once you run, however, you will see there is a data structure, there is an uninitialized data called that beef, which was one part of the sensitive data inside the SGX program. This is extremely critical issue because if you have complex software running inside the SGX, you can in fact keep getting some of the interesting data from the user space that can be a private key of your enclave program. Fortunately, Intel will be addressing this problem in next iteration of Intel SDK, so we'll be safe in pretty soon. So what about using high-level languages, memory-safe languages, notably Rust, which is getting a lot of attention these days? In fact, Baidu provide a Rust SGX SDK, but what about using this in the context of memory safety? Unfortunately, still suffer from the same issue, like SGX bleed. Even if you're using Rust-based SDK, we still get the sensitive data out of your program by exploiting this feature. However, I want to emphasize that using Rust, like high-level language, the memory-safe languages, is an extremely good solution if you care about memory safety inside the SGX. Those are all about the traditional attack vector. It's relatively not that interesting. So let's talk more about the specialized attack against Intel SGX. First, let me focus on page table attack. The fancy name of page table attack is called control channel attack. Unlike the cache-based side channel, they rely on a lot of non-deterministic behavior. The page table attack is kind of deterministic, so that the information you're getting from running the program is quite deterministic, so you can get a high chance of getting information out of your execution. The idea is pretty simple. The entire SGX program line operating system for page setting. So what if we carefully monitor the access pattern of the page table and page accesses, and we can kind of map this sequence of page information into the sensitive information. The attacker, the researcher demonstrate this attack in the context of image processing. So in the picture that you can see here, that when they run the image processing inside the enclave, you can kind of guess the edge of all the images, the source images to the image processing engine, even by simply checking the page table accesses. Let me show you how this attack works. We also create this a simple demo. So in the test program, as you can see, there are a bunch of functions. The function 1, function 0, and etc. When invoking test, it simply invokes the process secret as an argument. In this case, depending on the input, in this case, the S, E, C, etc., depending on the input that we are injecting, we're going to invoke this function. And every single function we carefully lay out in every single memory, every single pages. So we're going to compile without the defense mechanism that we're going to discuss later. So when we are executing this, and we start insert our module to the kernel because we are the privileged attacker, and we're also going to monitor the every single page table against the APC region. In this case, we set the trap in every single pages here between this memory region and just run the SGX program. So in the SGX program, we saw this sequence of page faults. In other words, we know the location of the each functions and simply figured out the actual input to the enclave program by checking those page table access pattern. So how could you defend against this particular attack? So we propose a TSGX. It's kind of a compiler technique so that given a SGX program, we can translate this program not suffering from these page table attacks. The key idea behind this TSGX is to utilize Intel TSX feature. It's a transaction synchronization mechanism. What's interesting observation we made And TSX is kind of isolate the fault when they're executing some of the fault inside their transaction. So in fact, this is a kind of byproduct of Intel TSX, which is different from SGX. Previously, we kind of used this information to break the ASLR of the kernel space, but in fact, we can even use it as a defense mechanism. So by wrapping the entire code inside this TSX, the transaction memory, so we simply create the transaction in the code section whenever the code fault or segment fault, and this entire TSX simply invoke the user space obol handler. In this case, a simple S statement here. So as you can, in TSX, we're gonna leverage this information. So we apply this one for every single basic block. So that if you compile SGX program, we're gonna insert a particular springboard. It's basically dispatching those the sequence of the transactions, and we're gonna keep wrapping every single basic block in this way. So whenever they trap, it fall back into the springboard and exit the entire program. In fact, it's not that easy to apply TSX to the arbitrary program because TSX has a lot of challenges, including it sometimes avoid, we call force abort, because of the capacity limitation of the TSX, it's extremely hard to estimate the size of the cache that you're touching. So in our compiler, we're gonna do the over approximation on those cache line accesses so that we can even break the basic block depending on the condition. Not only that, we do the intensive security analysis, so all the springboard and entry point of the enclave will stay in single page. So as an attacker, what you can get is the page that you allow to execute. And also we provide a lot of performance optimization like hosting the for loops and etc. typical compilation techniques. Let me show you. And it causes like decent performance overhead, the 50% if you really care about page table accesses, and it imposes about 30% memory overhead. Let me show you how it works. So this is the exact same vulnerable program that I demonstrated as a page fault attacks. So every single, when you execute this, depending on the user input string, they're gonna invoke the multiple function, function 1, 0, and etc. So unlike the other cases, we're gonna just enable the TSX in this case. And then we're gonna insert our, before running something, check whether the layout of the program. As you can see, all the functions lay out nicely per page so that as an attacker, you can see the access pattern on those pages. But when you run TSX enable application, this is basically monitoring the page access like similar demo. In this case, as an attacker, even though we insert the trap on those all the pages between the EPC region, we only get the page fault on those particular entry point, the beginning of the enclave program. Again, in order to be run inside the SGX, you kind of tell the very beginning of the page to the operating system, because otherwise there is no way I can figure it out the entry point of the program. So this is the only page that we are leaking when you enable the TSX inside your enclave program. So let's move on to other type of attacks, which is called branch shadowing attack. This is kind of new side channel, kind of unexpected. However, it's very fine grained, much fine grainer than, of course, the page table based accesses. And also it's much fine grained than cache based accesses. Cache line is basically 64 byte in typical architecture, but by using this particular side channel, you can tell the exact location of the branches, for instance. And also it's noise free, similar to the page table attack. So once you run, you can exactly tell which branch is taken, which branch is not taken based on this information. The intuition behind this is pretty simple. When SGX making a context switching between enclave code to the outside world, they simply forgot to flush branch target buffer. In other words, the execution history inside the SGX kind of affect the execution behavior, the performance of outside of program. But however, it's extremely hard to get this information because it's so performance sensitive. So we published our technical report about those details. So the key idea of branch shadowing attack is to exploit this new hardware, because it's extremely hard to figure it out whether the branch is taken or not, because performance difference is kind of negligible between them. Thanks to the new hardware feature for debugging for Intel architecture, they kind of provide last branch record and Intel processor tracer. In those cases, they're gonna explicitly inform you the fact that whether branch is taken or not. However, Intel engineer is not stupid. You cannot just apply this debugging feature against the running enclave. This is only for non-enclave program. So the approach that we took in branch shadowing attack is simply replicate the execution from the enclave to the outside. So we have two different execution going on. We first gonna run the enclave program and exit the program, and inside the non-enclave program, we're gonna apply the LBR so that we can get the prediction information in deterministic fashion. So this shadow replica has an interesting property, because in order to share those branch target buffer, we carefully lay out two program so that when you run the enclave program, the shadow copy got affected by the past history. And also again, we're gonna apply those two debugging features against non-enclave code rather than applying to the enclave code, which is not allowed. So in order to understand the attack detail, it's kind of complicated attack. So let me quickly describe the basics of branch prediction. In this particular assembly code, they compare the RxX value, and depending on the RxX value, they're gonna jump. If Rax is equal to 0, jump to the decrement, and otherwise go simply fall back to the increase instruction. So when we are executing this jump equal instruction, the prediction buffer simply tell them whether this is gonna take or not. And in this case, they're gonna say it's not going to take this conditional branch only if there is no history, of course, or if branch has not been taken in the past, then simply fall back to the next instruction in this case. On the other hand, if past execution took this conditional branch, then the prediction buffer simply say, hey, next instruction potentially be the potentially we're gonna take this instruction, the L1 will be the potentially next target, so that in terms of pipeline, they're gonna fetch the next potentially interesting next instruction in the pipeline. But how could you get those information? How could you differentiate this? One simple technique is by using the timer. In this case, if you measure the execution time, of course, there's just some difference between them, about 10 cycle. But if you see standard deviation, it's just so high. So sometimes there's so many other effects going on. In other words, in practice, you can tell the difference kind of, but there is not reliable information that when you're actually breaking something from the enclave, similar to the cache-based side channel. So our intuition behind this, we're gonna exploit the LBR MPT because it explicitly report the prediction result. But there are tons of caveat. They're gonna report those prediction result only on the taken branches. And also there's a capacity limitation. So you cannot just run the program, check those every single branches, because all the past execution will be flushed by those execution. So our approach to address this problem is that we're gonna translate all the conditional branch inside the enclave to the shadow copy to be taken. So I will tell you detail about those technique. And then we're gonna synchronize two execution. So after execute couple of instruction, we're gonna exit the program and check their branching state so that we can avoid the problem of limited capacity of those two debugging feature. So this is how we infer the conditional branch inside the enclave. This is exactly the same code. And first, we're gonna map this one to the shadow copy in a way that the two address region is colliding each other in terms of branch target buffer. So current architecture that we are using, they happen to share the last bit, but we know that some architecture doesn't provide this correct mapping. So you have to do the reverse engineering. So there's a separate paper talk about those, how to achieve those reverse mapping in this case. So again, when we are copying the shadow copy, we kind of align this memory region so that the execution history of enclave can affect the execution performance of shadow copy. Again, we're going to translate this one, every single conditional branch to be taken. So in this case, instead of comparing zero value with RAX, we're going to force the RAX value to be compared by itself. So this value will be taken always. And then we're going to run this one. When you're running this enclave, we basically can have two potential targets, either taken or not taken. And this information will be recorded in the branch target buffer. Again, this branch target buffer contains on the lower bytes of the memory, lower address of memory pointer, so that it can affect the execution of the non-enclave, the shadow copy. And LBR cannot simply apply to the enclave because it's a privileged operation. So here, we're gonna break this taken history of the enclave. Again, the shadow code is shared the same memory region. When we are executing, because we enforce the comparison to be true always, the prediction buffer simply make the right decision. So when we see this LBR, when LBR say this is correctly predicted because of the fact that we enforce this RAX value to be taken always, we can reverse back this logic, say the original branch target has been taken in the past, thanks to the report from the LBR. Similarly, when LBR report is not predicted correctly, then we can say that original execution is not taken in the past. That we can kind of reverse back those logics and original execution of enclave has been taken or not. Not only that, we can also provide the single stepping. So once you execute the entire program, you can kind of know the list of entire instruction by using these techniques. So there, because we are privileged attacker, we can modify the APIC timer, the precision of APIC timer. So we can enforce the timer will be generated very quickly. In this case, we can reduce down the execution up to 50 cycle. Not only that, we can disable entire cache so that we can slow down the entire program. In this case, we can basically reduce down to 5 cycle. So we can get the interrupt every five cycle so that we can easily synchronize both execution. So this is the attack that I'm going to launch against. First, this is the RSA exponentiation inside embed TLS. Inside this, there's an interesting computation. In this case, the ith bit of exponent. And depending on the value of EI, this is one of the exponent value, one bit. And they're going to do the interesting branch. So in case of EI is equal to 0, and they're gonna take those two branches. Otherwise, they're gonna fall into the other branches outside of this if statement. What if we keep monitoring this? Then we can basically learn about all the bits of exponent. In other words, we can kind of leak the private key of the RSA exponent. In this case, there's just some noise between those branches. So we are error rate is about 3-4. So that once we run a single function, we can kind of reveal the 66% of the private key. So if you run more than 10 times, like you can easily get the entire information. So let me show you how it works. So this is a embed TLS. So in order to check whether doing correctly or not, we actually provide a debugging message so that the EI is actually this to make sure the ground truth. And then these are the targets that we're gonna attack. Based on the EI value, EI is equal to 0, they're gonna take either of branches, otherwise it should fall back to outside of the if branch. It's basically one conditional branch inside. So this is a device driver they're gonna modify. Unfortunately, you cannot launch this attack in the user space because the memory space is not limited. Is limited, so you need a kernel space to reserve the kernel space to create this shadow copy so that they can map each other in terms of BTB. So this is a device driver, and we create the shadow copy. You can see a lot of nope. We ignore all the uninteresting branch, but we align each other so that we can enforce the condition branch so that we can infer those information. And this is how we are monitoring outside. And then while we are monitoring, we're gonna launch the enclave program. In this case, it keep displaying the ground truth. As you can see in the left right side, there is what we are monitoring. So whenever they execute this if branches, we're gonna infer the what are the correct branches to be taken. So as you can see, two executions kind of synchronize each other. So we can easily tell the EIG equal to 0, EIG equal to 1, so that we can break the entire RSA private key by using this technique. Right. As you can see, these are all 8 basically mean 0, 1 basically mean this value. So they are synchronized each other. Right. So what else we can do? Of course, breaking crypto is kind of fun, but it's not too immediate, I'll say. There are more high-level attack that we can launch. For example, think about how you program these library functions, like a string to integer conversion. You can see, you can imagine tons of if statement and switch statement, depending on your sign of your integer that you're providing, then they will take a different path. By using those information, if user invoke the string to L, you can know the length of the input, and you can know the whether it's a sign or zero and etc. Similarly, if program invoke the F printf, we know the format specifier because every format specifier is implemented as a if statement. So we can easily tell the enclave is converting something inside printf. Similarly, we can break the SVM, one of the machine learning, the K functions inside the SVM. Similarly, when they're running Apache, then we can tell the Apache program is handling GET requests or HTTP post request, for instance. So you can imagine how to apply this kind of attack to every single different application. There are tons of potential of leaking sensitive information that from the running enclave program. So how could you defend? First, you can simply flush the entire branch state from the enclave. But in fact, we don't have a hardware. There's no way we can emulate this. We create the simulation. So depending on the amount of execution inside the SGX, we're gonna keep flushing. So when we flush after 10,000 cycles inside the SGX, we kind of notice there's no performance difference between them. So 10,000 cycles is reasonable guess in terms of SGX program. So we believe flushing BTB when they're making context switchings kind of right decision. But unfortunately, this kind of implementation cannot be done by micro code update, because micro code update not have access to those kind of little detail. So meanwhile, we can use some software-based mitigation. This is compilation method. Although I didn't tell you how we break the indirect branch, unlike the condition branch, we can only break a single target of the indirect branch. In other words, keep leveraging this limitation of our attack. We can compile, we can convert all the conditional branch into the indirect branch so that we can make it extremely hard to break this program. This is another compilation component. We're gonna share this information soon with the public. So let's talk about another type of attack called Lowhammer. This work is also just published, so that we just presented to the public like about a week ago. This is kind of interesting attack because we can launch Lowhammer against EPC region, this SGX memory. And SGX memory consider this Lowhammer attack as integrity violation. Now, how could you deal with this integrity violation? They consider that a hardware attacker. So whenever there is a bit flip and the problem in their integrity, then they consider there is some snooping going on, some of the malicious devices launching the attack, for instance, so that they can stop the entire processor. However, by using Lowhammer, without accessing those hardware, we can launch, we can violate such integrity of the EPC memory region. So that we can simply do the Lowhammer against the EPC. Also, we can run this Lowhammer attack inside the SGX. So that if you want the details of the technique, please check this paper. But there are a few interesting things that I really want to emphasize. SGX simply assume such kind of violation only coming from the hardware. For them, disabling the CPU at the moment is kind of right decision. However, there's just huge implication by launching Rollhammer against SGX. First, we do the DOS against entire data center. Once CPU is freeze, you're gonna lose entire memory space. You're gonna lose all the running tenant, for instance. More difficult problem is how to do power recycle. In other words, normal way to manage those power is using IPMI, or all the management system are not working anymore because of the CPU itself is freeze. So it kind of require the physical human involved when you're restoring the entire CPU when attacker launched this particular attack. Not only that, it's extremely easy to trigger. Unlike typical Rollhammer attack that require a particular target bit, it just require a single arbitrary bit flip inside the entire EPC region. Once we flip one bit inside the EPC, the entire CPU will be freeze. And also, it's really hard to detect. For example, if you run something inside SGX, they cannot see some of the caching behavior, so they're just executing something, but you don't know what's going on. Not only that, the popular defense mechanism against the Rollhammer, particularly implemented in Linux kernel, mostly rely on PMU, like checking the cache misses and etc. But by running Rollhammer inside the SGX, there is no way you can observe those kind of behavior. So all the popular defense mechanism is not working against this type of attack. So let me show how it works. So this is the machine. Let's check how we can, this is a magic reset interrupt we can generate from the keyboard to the Linux kernel. So in the normal setting, you can do typical stuff, turning off, then do the magic system request, or you can just press the reset button of the SGX program. Here, we're gonna log in to the SGX machine that you can see as a background. And then we're gonna simply launch the SGX bomb. In this case, there's a timer going on. So after about 2 minutes, you can basically flip one bit in the EPC region and entire system is now freeze. You cannot do the, of course, generate the keyboard interrupt. Even you cannot generate the system request interrupt. At this point, the CPU is freeze. So it's not responding anything to the outside. So even if you press the reset button, the motherboard try to reset the CPU, but the CPU is not responding. But thanks to the current interesting features of this motherboard, after the CPU is not responding for a certain minute, it enforces the power recycle. So if we put this reset, it takes a little bit of time, but after some minute, they're gonna reset the entire CPU and restore the CPU processor in this case. Finally reset the CPU and start running the booting process. So think about these use cases in the data center. You run to this attack, the entire data center kind of freeze. There are a few defenses against the SGX bomb. The easiest solution is to use Rollhammer mitigation. In fact, Intel provides the sudo TRR. So if the DIMM support this particular feature, then you can kind of run avoid this particular problem of RAM. Not only that, if you're using EPC, you can make the problem difficult to exploit. But again, it's not completely invisible because we only require 2-bit flip in the arbitrary location, which is way easier than normal Rollhammer attack. And there are potential defense mechanisms that I can imagine. You can use on-core PMU so that instead of monitoring a simple core, there's a ton of other information you can observe, kind of memory bandwidth, for instance. Not only that, if you're being smart, you can design your memory allocator that never collide each other in terms of row. So you can make the attack impossible even in the software layer. This is my end of summary of my talk. Intel SGX, I believe, is a practical and promising building block to write a secure program. Intel SGX has an unusually strong threat model. It's because of this strong threat model, it opens a lot of attacks unexpected attacks. And today's talk is about recent attack and defense mechanism that we could see from the literature. And I believe it's not the future technology, it's already everywhere. So because you already have those features, and feel free to explore, and if probably can find some interesting application in your context. Thank you, and I will take some questions.